And thank you everyone for being here, the audience and the candidates. I'm sure we all look forward to our time together and the opportunity that we'll have to learn more about our candidates and how they wish to serve all of us. I would like to welcome you on behalf of the League of Women Voters and our congressional candidates, and also on behalf of the Cottonwood Chamber of Commerce, who is co-sponsoring this event with us. I am Mary Chiquin. I am a member of the Verde Valley chapter of the League of Women Voters, and I'm going to be the moderator this morning and working to make sure the process works effectively. Before we begin, I would please ask that everyone put their cell phone on vibrate or off.
Check ourselves too.
Thank you. A little bit about the League. The League of Women Voters is a nonpartisan political organization. Our mission is to encourage informed and active participation in government, work to increase understanding of major public policy issues, and influence public policy through education and advocacy. The League of Women Voters is nonpartisan and neither supports nor opposes any candidate or political party. The forum this morning, as a reminder, is for Republican candidates running for Congress from District 1. The purpose of this forum is to inform and educate ourselves about the candidates. The forum is being videotaped by Verde Valley Television, and I'd like to thank Ryan, who does this for us all the time, on Cable 1, Channel 56, and Suddenlink, Channel 2. It will also appear several times during the election season. You can also see this forum on YouTube. So if you have friends who are unable to be here this morning, please encourage them to watch and become more informed about our candidates. The candidates that we have present with us today are Paul Babu, Ken Bennett, Dave Gowan, and Sean Redd. Gary Keene and Wendy Rogers were unable to be with us. After the opening statements, I will be reading a statement from Wendy that she provided for us. The format for the forum is that each candidate will start with opening statements, and they will have 2 minutes to do that. We've asked them to respond during that opening statement, to share their reason for running and what their qualifications are, and to tell a little bit about what they think the biggest challenge facing the nation and district is and how they would resolve it. You have 2 minutes for that. Following these opening statements, the League has provided each one of the candidates with a question, which is, how do you propose to balance the needs of different areas of District 1 against each other and the needs of the district as a whole against the needs of the entire nation? And they had this question ahead of time, I believe, and they will also then have 2 minutes to respond to that. As the candidates are speaking, I invite you to fill out your questions on the 3x5 cards that probably were on the seats that some of the League members have in the back, because it's really important that the candidates have an opportunity to answer your questions. And you get to hear from them on the issues that you really think are important. Also, I'm sure the candidates will be available after the presentations to talk with you if you have specific questions you'd like to share with the candidates. Because we do have a time limit today, we will end at 11, and if we don't get to all the questions, which I'm sure you would like responses to, you can speak with the candidates individually. Before we get started, I'd like to introduce a few key people. Our timekeeper is Karen McClelland, and she's got three signs. 1 minute, 30 seconds, and stop. If you don't stop when she holds up the stop, I get to stop you. So this way we keep everything equal and on time. The other people that are helping us are Mary Gessaway, Robin Prudhomme-Bauer, and Ellie Bauer. They will be walking around picking up questions. If you have a question on a card, hold it up, okay, so that they can get it. And they will then be bringing the questions up to me so that we can get them responded to. And they will sort the questions so that we don't have the same question over and over again. I ask you, please ask you to be respectful when you write your questions. If they are not, we will not use them. So let's get started with the opening statements. Before we began today, each one of the candidates drew a number. So the way the candidates are seated is the way they will be responding to the questions. And we will start with Ken in his opening statement, but we'll go down the line so each candidate has a chance to speak first to different questions as we go through the process. The ending closing statements, Sean will be our first candidate to speak. So we reverse the process as we move forward. So with further ado, I would like to introduce Ken Bennett, who will do his opening statement.
Thank you, Mary. And thank you to the League and the Chamber for sponsoring this event. And thank you all for coming. I'm very blessed today to have my parents, my sister and her husband with us today. I'm Ken Bennett. First and foremost, I am a husband and father and a grandfather. I've been married to my wife, Jean, for 34 years. We have three grown children and three little grandsons, 6, 4, and 1. Next, I'm a businessman. I ran our family business in the Prescott area for 23 or 24 years, and for the last 8 years, I've been on the board of directors of a cancer hospital in the Phoenix area. So I have a 30-year business career. But simultaneous to that, I spent 25 years in public service, starting on the city council in Prescott back in the late 80s. Also served on the state board of education for 7 years while our children were going through the Prescott public school system. I served in the state legislature for 8 years, and 4 of those years I was president of the Senate. And then for 6 years I served as Secretary of State. I think it's important that we realize that things are broken in Washington. And if you're like me, you, I think, are tired and fed up with the broken promises that keep coming from Washington. And I am running to get America working again. And to me that means 3 or 4 main things. One is to get our financial house in order, to balance the budget, and quit borrowing from our children and grandchildren. Second is to get our economy growing at a much faster pace and get Americans back to work. Three is to get to keep our country safe, and that includes both home and abroad. We need to strengthen and rebuild our military, we need to secure the border, and we've got to make sure that we're keeping Americans safe. Was that the 1 minute or the 30 second? My goodness. 30 second. This goes, I don't know how we're supposed to explain the solutions to all of these problems, but I would just suggest that nothing will work or will not be able to solve any problems unless we get our financial house in order and balance the budget. I'll stop there and maybe answer some other questions later.
We are at war, yet we have not declared war. And what's so important about this, you see not just San Bernardino, you see Orlando, you see what happened in Nice, France, you saw Brussels and Paris. You see, in fact, our police officers here at home being gunned down, a target on their back. And I want to point out, we have an actual uniformed officer here. I just want to thank and appreciate all of our heroes in law enforcement for the amazing work that you do. You can absolutely applaud for him and for all of our law enforcement. We're in troubling times. You know who I am as a sheriff here. I've stood for 8 years as a very vocal public sheriff on a national level, confronting a lot of this executive overreach. Stood face to face with President Obama to challenge him on his executive overreach on the Second Amendment. We are facing within our own nation a culture of entitlement, a culture of appeasement, of apologizing to the enemies of America and abandoning our allies. I'm the only military veteran that's sitting up here today. Served 20 years, started as a private in the infantry, became a combat engineer, an army officer, served a tour in Iraq, commanded up to 1,100 active duty soldiers and airmen in Yuma. You'll hear people give speeches about border security, about fighting the drug cartels. Folks, I've done those things. If you want solutions to these problems, we elect leaders in America who are going to do something about it. Men, women who have sworn an oath to protect our country, who don't make promises and then turn around and do something different when they get into office. That's what I've done as a sheriff. That's what I've done my entire life of service to our country. That's what I will do as your representative. That's the title. And lest we forget, the most important office of the land is not the president, not a governor, not the speaker of the house or a sheriff. It's that of a private citizen. And this is a republic that we live in. And it's about time we stand up and put America and our citizens and our families first for once. And I will do that. Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Dave Gowan. I've served the great state of Arizona for the last 8 years at the legislature. I have a wife, Jessie, for the last 22 years. We've been married. And we have two sons, David Jr., who is an Eagle Scout. And he's actually going to school to be a mining engineer and a lawyer. Don't get on me on that one. My youngest son, he's 12 years old, Aiden James. He loves the stars. He loves the moon, rockets. He wants to be an astronaut. And they're the reason why I serve. They're the reason why I protect our liberties and our freedoms. You know, when I became a legislator in 2009, went down the state capitol, our budget was the worst in the United States by percentage. Worst in the United States. Looking forward, when I became Speaker of the House 2 years ago, we were still $1 billion in the hole. I'm proud to tell you today, looking forward, doing a budget a year earlier, we are structurally balanced. That's without raising your taxes. That's without printing money, because we can't. Looking towards veterans, talking about the veterans, I've been proud to serve as Military Affairs Public Safety Vice Chairman and Chairman for 4 years. I did that. In this budget that we did this year, I was able to obtain the resources to put forth the veterans' home in Flagstaff. And looking for our first responders, first time in several years that we've been able to give our raises to our DPS officers, our new troopers. I've been able to do that, and that's why I was able to get the Copper Shield Award from our Veterans Hall of Fame. Also, I'm endorsed by FOP, Arizona Police Association, the Troopers Association. These are the reasons why. And when you talk about the border and somebody who's done something, I'm the only one up here that has that experience of doing something and looking at what is occurring down there on the border. That's why I'm endorsed by Sheriff Joe Arpaio. I was the House sponsor of Senate Bill 1070, and we just put together the DPS. I know I'm this goes short. You're right, Ken. This is like
you.
short. So with that, I'll get through and explain that. Dave Gowan, gowanforarizona.com. Thank you.
Well, good morning, everybody. My name is Sean Redd. I appreciate everybody coming. We were just talking this morning. It's a shame that more people don't participate in our republic and take the civic responsibilities a little more personally and do their duties. I'm from a little town on the Navajo Nation up north of Winslow, about 30 miles north of Winslow, a little town called Dilkon. It's just south of the Hopi Nation. I'm a businessman. I'm not a politician. I've never run for office in my entire life. The reason I'm running is very simple. This district has been gerrymandered very directly, very specifically for one single purpose. It's been gerrymandered to include 13 Native American tribes that make up 25% of the voting electorate in this district. And they did that to give the Democrats the absolute advantage. They have destroyed our candidates in the last two races by over 9,000 votes. That's not something you can overcome with a get-out-the-vote effort. That's not something you can do with anything else. All the candidates here know they have one simple mission. After the primary, they have to get Democrats to vote for them. I am the only candidate in this race that includes the Republican elephant on all of my materials. And the reason is very simple. Because I know where I'm going to get my Democrats. I'm going to reach out to the people that I've built relationships and done business with for 20 years doing business on the Navajo Reservation. And I can use those relationships to get them to vote for me because they simply understand that I know the Native American issues better than any other candidate in this race, Democrat or Republican. They know I'll do more for them in Washington than any other candidate. This is an extremely diverse district. I grew up off the reservation. I grew up in the business world, but I live on the reservation and I understand those. I've been around minorities. I've been around mining. I've been around business. I've been in metropolitan areas. I've been in rural areas. I know this district, I know the issues of it better than any candidate there is. And the biggest thing is that I'm a candidate that can win in November. All of these type of events are very fun to participate in. It's good to hear the answers. It's good to do all these things. But at the end of the day, it does not matter if we don't nominate a candidate that can win. And I'm a candidate that can win in November. Sean Ridd. Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. At this time, I'm going to read a statement that Lieutenant Colonel Wendy Rogers submitted to me. I will be reading it verbatim from what she sent me. Lieutenant Colonel Wendy Rogers is a fifth-generation military officer in the United States Air Force. After retiring from the Air Force after 20 years of active duty, Colonel Rogers and her husband, Hal, who is also a retired Air Force officer, started their own home inspection business. Their crew of Arizona-licensed home inspectors has worked throughout Coconino, Yavapai, Pinal, and Maricopa counties. Rogers has a bachelor's and master's degree in social work from the University of Alabama. In addition to her degrees in social work, Colonel Rogers holds a second master's degree in national security studies from Cal State San Bernardino. Rogers is a mother of two and a grandmother of three. Colonel Wendy Rogers has dedicated her life in service to our nation, and she wants to go to Congress to serve her country again. Rogers bicycles to 100 doors per day to hear what Arizonans want from their congresswoman. Rogers prioritizes national security, and as a veteran, she is uniquely equipped to fight for our safety in Congress. Rogers has the political will it takes to finally secure our border. As a small business owner, Rogers understands the detrimental effect of federal overreach and will go to Congress to fight for your economic prosperity. Vote for Wendy Rogers in August to send a principled military veteran and small business owner to Congress to make Washington work for us again. Thank you. We will next go to the prepared question that the candidates received. And let me repeat it just so that you have it again and the audience hears it. And with this question, Paul, we'll be starting with you.
Absolutely.
Okay? So the question is, how do you propose to balance the needs of different areas of District 1 against each other and the needs of the district as a whole against the needs of the entire nation?
The most important issues that everybody talks about, jobs and the economy. We're talking almost every debate, or at least I bring up, about the EPA. When I mentioned federal overreach, it's exampled and evidenced in what we've been seeing with the EPA. And President Obama, not through law, not through Congress passing a law, but through rulemaking and policy through the EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency, is killing coal. Now you see the Democrat nominee, Hillary Clinton, what did she say to the media? She's going to close all these coal mines and put these miners out of work. Why should that concern everybody here? I'm going to tell you why. Because there's four coal-fired generating stations in Arizona. Guess where they're located? In this district, District 1. And they mine this coal for what? These generating stations generate electricity. Who here pays electric? Just about every one of us, right? The estimates is 40% increase of your electric bill. So if you pay $200 a month, guess what? That conversion cost, because it's $11.5 billion, is going to be passed on to us as ratepayers. At a time we can least afford it, jobs in the economy, 95 million Americans, highest number in the history of our country, are not in the workforce. And President Obama says, not ISIS, not an unsecured border, but this global warming is the top national security threat to America. That's the problem. And so how do you balance? That's the same problem in Pinal County as it is in Navajo or Coconino County. Jobs in the economy. We're going to put, by this Obama policy, nearly 3,000 people out of work. Price of electric and water, CAP is the largest customer to deliver water to my county for ag as well as for drinking, and to Maricopa County. That's significant. That's one of many issues that I'll talk about. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, absolutely. You know, that's a great question, actually.
Thank you.
And the interesting factor is, who up here has that experience of doing that already? And I have, especially the last 8 years. You know, serving at the state legislature, when you get in, you think about all the bills that come in, and first of all, you start to think, what do I do for my district? That's what I've done. You think about your district, and then the different areas of the needs. And then you float to the state level, and you say, what does the whole state need? And these are the things you actually have to weigh through that whole 8 years that I've been there. And when you push that button and you say yes or no, you have to know in your heart that you're doing the right thing. And what's interesting is, size of my district, legislative district, is the size of Massachusetts. The size of this district is the size of Pennsylvania. It's a large district. It has a lot of communities in it. You know, being the majority leader before and now Speaker of the House, I've had to take that diverse state and look at it and actually bring in the legislators from the different regions and discuss their issues with them and then make the decisions at that point of what's best for the whole. I've already done that. That's the thing I want to do when I get back to Washington, D.C. When I land on the plane and I take the oath, I'm not looking for the restroom. I'm shaking hands, taking names, and I'm saying, what do we need to do here? And making the relationships that I've built here in this great state, doing the same thing there. So when we're talking about all these other issues that are coming up and experience, you have somebody with the utmost experience right here, especially when you're talking about the issues at hand, when we're talking budget, when you're talking veterans, when you're talking border security, you're talking EPA, we sued and won. But right now, they're at a standstill. Talking WOTUS, Waterways of the United States, we fought and sued and put them on hold. We've done those things already, and we plan to do that when we get back to Washington. Thank you.
Thank you, Dave.
I often tell a story about one of the reasons I got into this race. One of the reasons I got in is because a fellow named Rick Renzi helped my dad in a time of need. He was a congressman from this area. My dad never got veteran benefits. He was drafted into the Korean War. It was just a political, bureaucratic mess that he had fallen through the cracks and had been left out of receiving his benefits. I brought this up to Rick. Rick actually brought the Deputy Secretary of Veteran Affairs to Window Rock. In a few minutes with that gentleman, that problem was solved for my dad and many other people that were in that same position. A United States representative goes into the House of Congress. You're a member of a 435-member chamber. I hear these guys talk about, I did this and I did that at the State House. That's not a comparison. There's more people in the Congress, 435 members, than there is both the state representatives, the state Senate, and most of the county governments. It's a major deal. It's not something that you can go into and make a lot of changes as a freshman representative. You've definitely got to go in there. You've got to bring people to your side. You've got to bring them in. You've got to make them understand the issues of the first congressional district. As your representative, the way that I will be able to help the people of this district is by simply traversing this great big district. As a businessman, I've averaged over 10,000 miles a month all of my entire life. I will continue to meet with the local constituents at the local level, meet with the local governments, and find out what their needs are and help them. I will be your representative. I'll be your point of contact to help you with the bureaucracy in Washington, D.C. That is what you need as a representative. That's what I needed, and it was done for me, and that's the reason I'm running for Congress. Of course, I'm the first Native American to ever seek the Republican nomination. The Native Americans make up 25% of this district. You talk about a diverse district, I have been around minorities all of my life. I've been around the large LDS contingent. I've been around metropolitan areas. I know all of the issues that this district does better than any candidate. Thank you.
Well, Mary, it's a good question, but I want you to listen carefully because it implies something that I think we have fallen into as a country, and that is, how do you balance the needs of the different parts of the district against other parts of the districts? We shouldn't be thinking of government as dividing up some pie or something, and if it gives more to one, it has less to give to another. We don't have to balance the needs of the district against each other because all the needs of the district in all of the different varieties can all go forward if we get government out of the way and allow the economy to grow. It was just announced that for the first time in the history of our country, our economy has grown by less than 2% a year for 10 years in a row. First time in 230 years of being a country that economic growth has been less than 2% 10 years in a row. There are 90 plus million Americans out of work, and they're scattered through all the district. And we shouldn't have to think about how to take away from someone else to give to someone over here. I found that when I ran our family business and have been involved in other businesses, that a rising tide lifts all boats, and if you get the economy, if you get your business growing, if you increase sales and revenue, then you can give pay increases to everybody and you can move everyone forward. When I was president of the Senate, I was the leader of the Senate and I was a Republican, but we had a Democrat governor, Janet Napolitano. We passed four balanced budgets while I was Senate president. But during those 4 years, we not only passed budgets that balanced the budget and eliminated accounting tricks and gimmicks and cut taxes, those budgets also increased money to education, to universities, child protective services. On those four budgets, we got 15 out of 17 Republicans to support those budgets and 11 out of 13 Democrats to support those same budgets. That's the kind of leadership we need in Washington to bring people together and move everybody forward. It's not one against another.
Thank you all. The next question, I'm going to combine a couple of questions because it sort of addresses what you've already responded to. But I think the part of these two questions is really important. The audience is asking you to identify what your key needs are. But there is great concern as to how you will work across party lines, how you will work to achieve what the nation needs, and how you can work together to improve the country as a whole across party lines. And Dave, you're first.
I am first. Thank you. Another good question. You know, it's interesting. You look at who I am, what I've been able to accomplish at the state legislature, and I can't believe some of the stuff that has occurred. Coming in as a freshman, you have to learn things. And one thing I did learn was Maricopa County, out of 30 districts, 18 come from Maricopa County. And that was the epicenter of the state. It's just most of the people are there. So what you need to do is reach up to those guys and shake hands and say, hey, how can I help you? You find the common values, you find the common views. And I'm the first Southern Arizona speaker in almost 30 years. And there's a reason for that. You look at the 18 out of the 30 that come from Maricopa, 12 are outside of Maricopa. How do you do that? You reach across and you shake hands. And you say, how can I help you? How can I help you? How can I help you? And then again, how can I help you? And at the point when you say, I need a little help, do you mind helping? They say, not at all. It's about relationship building. It's just like businesses. How do you build your business up? You build relationships all around you. And from that, I was able to become the majority leader of the House, coming from a rural area, and now speaker. And I understand the diversity, again, as I was talking about earlier, of this great state and the different portions. I understand, even as I'm a Republican, the Democrats are elected by their constituency from their districts, and everybody deserves a voice. Now, they deserve a voice, doesn't mean we actually go down the same aisles together, but certainly we can talk about the issues and put forth most of the stuff. I tell you, 90% is bipartisan. It's only about that 10% where you have to fight a little bit and try to get that way. But with that, I've done it, and I'll continue to do that when we get to the federal level. Thank you.
Thank you, Dave. Sean.
I moved out to the reservation for a very specific reason. I had a lot of opportunities in my life. I grew up in a very fortunate household. I moved out to the reservation to advance conservative policies, to advance economic development, to bring opportunities to some of the people that are struggling as much as anybody in the country. When I moved out there, obviously I have a unique set of skills, and I got very involved in politics. I got involved with the administrations. I told them, I said, if you're going to call yourselves a sovereign nation, you need to issue tribal license plates. Any sovereign jurisdiction in the country issues their own license plates. And they said, well, that's great, Mr. Red, but we don't know how to do it. I said, well, I happen to grow up in a car dealership, and I know all there is to know about issuing license plates. I've been around it all my life. They said, well, Mr. Red, if you think you can do it, why don't you go ahead and see what you can do? I was about a 25-year-old kid. I went into three governor's offices and told them that this was a inherent right of the Navajo Nation and the Navajo people to issue tribal license plates. Two Democrat governors. And without any argument or anything else, a 25-year-old kid convinced those governors. I had no attorneys, no staff, no anything else. I just went into their offices, laid out the case, brought them to my side, and made them understand what needed to be done. It's an ability that I've been given, and that's what I'm trying to do to represent the 1st Congressional District. That is what you need, is somebody that can go in and talk with people, relate to people, lay out the facts, lay out the case, and bring them to your side and make them understand beyond partisan politics what is good for the people. And that is what I can do. Of course, I always laugh because a lot of people, they look at me as a Navajo and they say, well, he's probably fairly liberal. And then they start hearing me talk and they say, goodness, Mr. Red, you're awful conservative. And I am. I'm extremely partisan. But I still make people understand what needs to be done, and I bring them to my side. And that's what I'll do for you in Washington. Thank you.
I think the first part of the question was identifying key needs and how are you going to work together to get those accomplished. As I mentioned earlier, I think our number one priority is to get our financial house in order. Yes, we're at war, but we're not going to be able to strengthen our military, secure our border. We're not going to be able to get the economy growing if our financial house is in shambles like it is in this country. We have a little over $3 trillion of tax revenue that comes into the federal government, but we spend almost $4 trillion. When I went to college, the national debt was $1 trillion. Today, it's approaching $20 trillion. If a family had the amount of debt to its income as the federal government has, and the annual average household income in America is a little over $50,000, that household would have $300,000 on their credit card balances. And their long-term debt, like we have in this nation for Social Security and Medicare, a mortgage is your long-term debt usually in a family. That family making $50,000 would have a mortgage of over $1.6 million. Now that's not sustainable. You can't be making $50,000 a year, spending 60 or 70, you've already got $300,000 on your credit cards and your mortgage is $1.6 million. We've got to get our financial house in order. I support what's called the penny plan. In fact, I've proposed a variation to it. We can balance the federal budget in 4 years. If you trim federal spending by 1% a year for 4 years, and if you get the economy growing at 3.5% instead of the less than 2% that it's been doing for 10 years in a row, the federal budget can be balanced in 4 years. I'll go back. How would I work together? I'll go back to what I did as president of the Senate. Janet Napolitano would propose a budget to us. I was the leader of the Republicans. It was always spend every dime that she could find anywhere in state government. I pushed back, and we got the budget balanced. And I not only got 15 out of my 17 Republicans, I got 11 out of 13 Democrats to support those budgets.
Thank you.
How do you work with people with different opinions, different parties? If you've ever had the opportunity to call 911, you will know we do not ask if you're a Republican or a Democrat, right? We provide a service. In fact, oftentimes us in law enforcement are working with people we would never want to normally associate with. So our ability to do that is quite high. The issues that are most important, I mentioned I'm so proud of my service, 20 years in the reserve component, serving in Iraq, a tour, commanding soldiers here, responding to natural disasters here in our country. That's a top priority. We as a nation love our military, say we appreciate them, yet we have allowed the breaking of a solemn promise to care for our veterans after they've served their country. Have we not? 22 veterans will kill themselves on average today. 22 committed suicide yesterday and the day before. And this scandal that has happened in our state, nobody has gone to jail. This is outrageous. These are crimes not just because they doctored the books for scheduling to get a bonus and pay. People have died. Our heroes have died. And this is what I've been saying, and I get a national platform at times to say President Obama and this administration has elevated refugees and asylum seekers. We're treating them better, actually giving them more money per year than we do our senior citizens on Social Security. We treat them better than we treat our own military veterans. That's outrageous. It's going to take veterans like myself to fight to reform this. That's why Defend America has come out and endorsed me, saying we used to have 40 years ago, 71% of the members of Congress had military service. Now it's 14%. So don't scratch your head trying to figure out why we're in a lot of these messes. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question, and I would ask you to hold your applause until the end of the forum. Thank you. The next question, we will start with Sean. What is your position on climate change? What will you do to protect vulnerable populations from extreme weather?
Well, climate change is something that I don't agree with. I certainly don't. I'm against a lot of the EPA regulations that are out there. I believe that a lot of the Clean Air Act and stuff that the EPA is proposing, I believe that's detrimental to our society. It hurts our economy, it hurts our jobs, it reduces our ability to progress as a nation. I believe that you look at these wildfires that we just endured here in Navajo County, or over in Navajo County, those wildfires emit more emissions than the driving population of this nation does in years. In a single day, a wildfire puts out more than cars can put out in years. So I'm against those type of regulations. I'm somebody that I believe, obviously, we've got to have strong stewardship of our lands. We've got to take care of our natural resources, and we've got to protect our planet for future generations. But the policies that are put forth by the Democrat Party are not helping the nation. They're not helping our environment. They're not doing what they're supposed to be doing. I talk about all the famous things that Richard Nixon did in his life. The EPA certainly has not worked out very well. And that's not something we've talked about very often. They always just talk about the other things that he had done. But again, that's my position. I'm somebody that strongly believes that our coal mines, our resources need to be done. The timber industry needs to be allowed to grow and go from there. So as far as the environment goes, like I say, as a Native American, that's something that we hold very dear to our hearts. But good stewardship is not in line with what the federal government is doing with their EPA policies. Thank you.
I believe climate change is a natural occurrence that occurs because of the way the Earth exists. We have cooling and warming periods. I can remember going to school in the 70s being told that we were on the verge of falling into the next ice age. And now 20 or 30 years later, we're talking about global warming. And so if we understand, and at least my belief is that the Earth is a living organism. About half the species on the Earth breathe oxygen and emit carbon dioxide, and the other half do the opposite. And we can contribute to that warming by being irresponsible as humans, but I don't think we can put all of the blame for global warming on human activity. And so I support us as human beings being responsible in our environmental policies and the way that we conduct our affairs so that we're not destroying this wonderful gift, this planet that we have. But I don't believe that it's human activity that is the primary cause of global warming or cooling. And so I think the Earth goes through cycles, and we're in a kind of a warming cycle right now. Having said all that, I will make sure that what we do at the federal government level is based on science and fact and is not picking winners and losers. It should not be the federal government's role to decide, well, we're going to put one industry out of business to help other people or other countries or other places of the world that we think are affected by that business. So we've got to put America and Americans first, and we've got to be responsible in the way that we conduct our affairs and how we treat the environment. But I do not believe that we as humans are the primary response or cause of what we hear about in climate change.
In the name of protecting our environment, we are destroying it. Think of that for a moment. You just drive down the road and you can see the effect of wildfires. This is what's happening, and this is the agenda that's been promoted for decades, and it's quickened now at a time when we're facing true national security threats and concerns. The president announces in Paris, of all places, after the first terrorist attack there, he announces to the world that this is the top priority for a national security threat facing the United States. Almost like if we're the only nation on the earth What about China? What about India? Right? Everybody has affects the environment. And yet, for the president, at a time we can least afford it, 95 million Americans out of work, is implementing through his executive power this rulemaking and policy that'll destroy our economy at a time we can least afford it. That's going to increase everyone's utility bills. And the Democrat that we're going to face has been the president of an environmental group for the past 4 years, folks. And I've heard him, in his own words, say he doesn't trust Republicans to clean the environment or the pollution, and he supports Obama's clean power plan. That's our ticket to victory right here. The other thing that I'll mention is that Democrat Kirkpatrick, the last two cycles, this incumbent member of Congress, Jonathan Payton, Andy Tobin, who supported and endorsed me, they're sitting there, and Ann Kirkpatrick would say, he can't even vote for himself because he doesn't live in the district. How's he going to represent us? That's powerful. We all live in this district, and we can represent us, and this is an open seat. So these issues, there's far more pressing issues while you're running down people, down pedestrian pathways, and you're killing people en masse in our country. We have to put our priorities in order.
Thank you. Yeah, there's a lot of issues with that. Certainly, you've heard here today, which I believe, it's not man-made. I mean, a volcano puts in more carbon monoxide than the whole industrial period. We have to think about what's happening on this earth and think about, my degree is education social studies, so I know a bit about history and going back and looking at the different time periods and when we had cooling and warming. The earth does that as it revolves around the sun, and then the sun has its sunspots, and the different things that occur in nature happen in that fashion. And the interesting factor is we're using it as a political tool to get things such as the EPA coming out and talking about our Clean Air Act, coming in and trying to control our coal fire plants. And how are they doing that? They say, well, we want to stop the emissions of the coal fire plants by 34%, but not Arizona. Let's go after them for 52%. A little different. You know why? Because Arizona's free. Because we're the freest state in the nation. And there's a reason why we are. Because of the people who live here. Because of what our values are. Who we are. We need to take these values back to Washington and tell them to respect the West. You know, it's an interesting factor. We talk about water, too, when you get to the water situation. And you look over here in California, they want water. There are 53 congressmen over there, House members. There are 9 here. How are we going to counter those guys? You have to have somebody who's built coalitions. I've done that at the state level. We need to make friends with Texans, the Georgians, Floridians, get 150 together. That's how we're going to stop this ideology from coming forward so that we can make our businesses free, we can get the government off the back, take the regulations away. That's the things we need to do to get our economy rolling back around. Thank you.
Thank you. Ken, we're going to start with you on this question. And the question is, how could you better respond to the needs of the people in your district? How could you better respond?
Well, the first thing would be to get elected so that I'd be their representative and could respond to them. But I don't think that's really what the question is about. I would do the same thing that I did as a city councilman, as a member of the State Board of Education, as the CEO of a family business, as a member of the legislature. You listen to people. When I was in the legislature, I was known as having an open door policy. Anybody could come in and visit with me. Even during the 4 years that I served as the president of the Senate. And one of the things that I did as Secretary of State, for example, and I'll tie this into the League of Women Voters. I was asking Robin earlier if she had contact with Dr. Barbara Klein, who used to be the Arizona president of League of Women Voters. When I became Secretary of State, I found out from my staff that the old way of updating what's called the State Elections Procedures Manual. There's a bunch of laws in statute how we're supposed to run elections, but there's an election procedures manual. It's about 400 pages long, and the Secretary of State's office is responsible for updating that every 2 years. I asked the staff, how do we do that? Well, we get a couple of our friendly county recorders together, and we just do what we do, and then we tell everybody else what we did. I said, that doesn't sound right. We should invite every county recorder, all 15 counties. We should invite every county elections director. We should invite other organizations that are interested in our election process. So we invited the League of Women Voters and Mi Familia Vota and all of the parties. And we had 8 or 10 meetings over the course of a year, and people got to participate. And I was rewarded when Barbara Klein wrote the nicest letter to the Arizona Republic saying, here's an example of a public servant that puts the public first and allows people to participate in the process. And we adopted a new election procedures manual, and we had the best working relationship ever between the state and the counties because we opened the door and listened to people and let them participate.
Thank you. Paul?
We've got some good candidates here, and I could tell you, Ken Bennett, Speaker Gowan, Sean Redd, the other candidates, any one of us, quite frankly, would be far better than the representative we have, I can tell you that. And all of us have committed to support one another, whoever emerges as our nominee, to take this seat back. And the issues, why we'd be better? Because I can tell you, first as a lawman, you had a murder that occurred right here in the Verde Valley by an illegal from what country? You would know, from Russia. And every sheriff in the state, we spoke out about this publicly. We announced 3 violent, dangerous criminals were released back into Arizona when they should have been deported to their home country. And I ask people oftentimes, what country are they from? You already know one of them. And they'd inevitably say Mexico. And we did this for a reason, because half of the sheriffs are, like myself, Republican. The other half are Democrat. We had a unified voice. One's from Russia, one's from Sudan, one's from Iraq. And they were released, 2 murderers, and the murderer who stabbed a person here in the Verde Valley, while 2 other Russian gang members were present, they kidnapped this person from Phoenix, brought him up here, and then doused him with gasoline, lit him on fire to torture him to his death. They released that murderer in my county, and then tell me, the sheriff, 2 weeks after the fact. That's what's wrong. And why we would represent this district better is because this member of Congress was silent. It was absolute crickets. No outrage, no mention, no sheriff, what can I do, or sheriffs of the state, what can I do to protect the families of our state? My God, she has a liberal Democrat agenda, voting for these against our country in so many different ways. We would be better, any one of us. I know that for a fact.
Thank you.
Thank you. Maybe that question should be aimed at the current representative in the district here. Certainly, when you talk about the issues at hand, we've had a lot of good questions, and we're talking about the issues of what are the different diverse communities have in common, and what will we vote on for them, and how would they interact? Well, certainly, you're looking at a few out there, and you talk about EPA stuff a lot. And that's talking about shutting jobs down our economy. How would you do better? You'd make sure that you back up the businesses, take away regulations, cut the taxes as we need them. Let's get people back to work. That's the thing we need to do here. That's what I plan to do as your House member in Congress, and always as I've done at the state legislature. How to become majority, how to become Speaker of the House? Well, you're always learning. And you're always looking at your values and expanding spots. Now, I have principles. And these principles that I hold near and dear to my heart, we don't cross. Everybody knows that. I have an open door policy. People come and talk to me, and they say, hey, can we move this legislation forward? Well, not if it's touching my principles. But above that, we can talk about it. We could do those situations. Be communicative. Talk about the issues with your constituency. I've always gone out to the constituents. I've always talked to them. I've always presented what I've done at the legislature. Always listened to what they have to say to me, so I know and I'm informed when I go and vote on their behalf. What I plan to do when I become the congressman such a large district, size of Pennsylvania. I want to put an office in the south. I want to put an office in the north. But then we have such a large rural region. I want to make a mobile office that goes around and interacts with our constituency all around the district. That's the plan, and that's what I plan to do when I get back to Washington. Thank you.
Thank you, Dave. Sean.
I believe exactly like has been said here. I think the biggest thing is getting elected and comparing ourselves to the Democrat opposition. Again, the Democrats feel very confident about retaining this seat. They have a 10% voter registration advantage. They've won the last two cycles handily. They're very confident going into this. So the way I will do it is obviously taking our conservative principles to Washington. There's policies that work, and there's policies that fail. There's some businesses that succeed, and there's some businesses that fail. It's very clear the reasons why. I've lived in Democrat towns, and I've lived in Republican towns. And you can see the difference in leadership just by walking the streets. You can see the success. When you hear about these cities that are failing across the nation, you don't have to ask. You know what kind of leadership they have without even asking. It's always the same. Conservative policies work and the liberal policies don't. That's just how simple it is. And of course, that's the way that I will be a better representative, is by representing our conservative values, our conservative principles, taking policies that work to Washington and seeing them go through the Congress and become law at the federal level. Again, that is the biggest difference that we have. As Paul said, any of us would be better than the Democrat opposition. But the simple fact is, who can win? That's the biggest question, and that's what I represent. That's the reason I'm a better candidate, is because that I can win in November, because of my ability to reach out to the different minority groups, to the rural groups, and get the votes that it's going to take to win this seat back, turn this district red. Thank you.
Thank you. As we move forward, I have a great deal of questions. So some of them I'm going to limit to you to 1 minute responses on, so that people can hear more from you. This next question, they get 1 minute on, all right? And it's the more specific questions. And I believe we start with Paul. What would you do to reduce the cost of healthcare and specifically prescription drugs?
One, not only roll back, repeal Obamacare, certainly this is something that's a part of the Republican agenda. What President Trump, who I and all of us support here, to have a Republican administration and a Republican agenda, get the federal government out of the relationship between doctors and her or his patients in that care. When you see, I just had a friend of mine, a strong supporter, saying, who's in the prescription drug industry, and he's saying, I just paid for myself for a no-name brand, 300 and something, that cost them literally dollars. And some of the problems that exist in the industry right now is the cost is out of control. I have family members who work in prescription drugs, and the sales and the regulation from the federal government has been extreme to raise the cost for us as the users.
That's short. Well, certainly you're hearing it, repeal Obamacare, and what are you going to replace it with? Well, there are three factors here. Insurance across state lines. I believe we need to relinquish that, allow the states to do that, and be able to get the process going with that. Small businesses, letting them conglomerate together so that they can get a larger mass, so that they drive the healthcare costs down when you insure for your employees. Also, health savings accounts. When you do those, you're allowing people to save pre-tax dollars and utilize those when they go to their doctor. And as you're hearing up here, stay out of the way of the relationship between the doctor and the person. Get out of that way, and I think by getting rid of Obamacare and putting those three aspects into play, we're going to create a great healthcare system like we have been. And you know, we're the only place in the world where you have England and Canada that want to come to us because they can't get it done there themselves. We don't want to go that way. We want to get back to where we were in the free market.
Thank you. Sean.
As a Native American, I participate in the Indian Health Service. I know about federal health care. It's It's not definitely not the best system. The free market works better. We need to support those principles. I see the struggles that my dad has at the VA, again, and of course down in Phoenix, all the news that has come over the wires here in the last couple years about the struggles that they're having. This is a state issue, and we need to support state rights when it comes to this. As far as federal regulations, I concur with Mr. Gowan that we need to allow companies to sell across state lines. We need to open up the free markets and allow them to compete, allow them to work, and allow them to serve the people. Thank you.
Generally, we have to move in the direction of the market forces that Sean and Dave were talking about, as opposed to trying to centralize things in government. But since it's only a minute, I want to focus on the prescription drugs. One thing that would reduce prescription drug prices is to allow the federal government, Medicaid, Medicare, to contract with the drug companies so that they would pay lower prices for those drugs. We prohibit our own federal agencies, Medicare and Medicaid, to contract with the drug companies to get a reduced price, while those same drug companies go all over the rest of the world and sell their drugs at much lower prices in other countries than they sell right here in the United States. One of the other things that we need to do is respect the wishes of people as far as end of life issues and do not resuscitate orders and things like that. I met with the head of one of the largest health corps. I don't have time to get into that then right now. Sorry.
I'd like to hear it though.
Okay, the next question you have 2 minutes on. What can you do to help as a congressman to help balance the budget? Please be specific.
Wow. Well, I'll tell you what. As I spoke about in my opening monologue, and you know, the theme here that I'm trying to express out to everybody is experience does count, especially when you're looking for a congressman. And somebody to go into the abyss that you see back there in Washington, D.C. You need somebody that has the ability to take your voice and utilize that experience and get down on the ground, build relationships, build the coalitions I was talking about earlier, to force this federal government into living within its means. And, you know, at the state level, I talked about it. In 2009, our budget was $11.4 billion. We were only receiving $6.5 billion revenue in the following year. Through that process, without us being able to print money, because we cannot do that, we had to live within our means for the last 8 years and walk through the process and looked at how we did it. And certainly what we did in the great state of Arizona was we got off the backs of art businesses and we helped them. How do you help them? You look for ways to deregulate, and you pull the regulations away. We talk about health and public safety, absolutely. That's where we stand as a government. We know government is about public health and safety. But when you get past that, and you put requirements on hoop after hoop after hoop, it damages our economy, and it doesn't allow people to get back to work. We have so many bureaucracies out there. We need to fix that. Get them under control, reduce the taxes, the burden to our businesses, allow our workers to get back to work, the people here, and we're going to see the economy go like we did here. Kiplinger just rated us number 2 in the nation in job growth now. And as I stated to you before, now we're structurally balanced. We could do that at the federal level. I have the blueprint. I want to get back there and do that. Thank you.
Sean.
I use that slogan, a conservative that can win. And I often hear from constituents, well, what does it mean to be a conservative? Well, conservative is very simple. Smaller government, less waste, less regulation, less needless spending. Those are the conservative values that I support. That's how you reduce the budget. You cut out a lot of the spending that doesn't need to happen. The overreach of the government is definitely a waste and an excess. They're talking about creating these monuments out here. Those are things that we don't need to do. We don't need to see the federal government do. Those are the type of things that continue to waste our dollars, to continue to put us into deficit spending. As a conservative, I will oppose everything we can as far as earmarks and needless spending, especially in fruitless efforts like studying worthless concepts and hypotheses. We don't need to be putting money into that. We need to be putting money into priorities. The government central functions, military, strong national defense, things like that. Those are the principles that I support, and I certainly oppose all the wasteful efforts. And of course, you want to see it in practice. I have never run for office before, and I'm running against some extremely competent, well-funded, skilled politicians, and yet I'm competing, and I'm being outspent 200-1 probably. So I practice what I preach. Thank you.
Ken?
As I said earlier, I referred to a thing called the penny plan. The penny plan was an idea from a congressman in Florida that if you trim the federal spending by 1% a year, at the time it would have taken 6 years. As things have changed over the last few years, you can actually get it done in 3 to 4 years. Federal spending is just a little over $3.8 trillion. Now, you can go to a lot of websites, and you will get the impression that we spend all of our money in three areas: Social Security, Medicare, the military, and by the time you add interest on the national debt, there's hardly anything left that we could cut. I dug into all of that spending as I did at the state level. I balanced the federal budget, or the state budget. We can balance the federal budget. One of the websites I went to said this Social Security is $1.4 trillion a year. Now, if Social Security is 1.4 and Medicare is 1.1 and military is 600, pretty soon you've spent almost all of your $3.8 trillion, and it would give you the impression that there's not much left to cut. But Social Security, what they do is they bury some other things that are hidden into those numbers. Social Security is actually $900 billion a year. That's our largest single item. But it's not $1.4 trillion. There's $500 billion of other things called income security. This is where all your food stamps come in. This is where your housing credits and subsidies. This is where all your tax credits for earned income tax credits and child tax credits. In Medicaid and Medicare, they assume that it's all in Medicare, when in fact there's $500 billion in Medicaid, which is health care for the poor. As we get people back to work, we can trim spending in these areas. Medicare released a report just a couple of months ago saying that of the $600 billion that they spend each year, their own estimates are that 10% of that, $60 billion, is waste, fraud, and abuse. We can trim 1% a year for 4 years, get the economy growing, and the budget will be balanced.
We can't get there with waste, fraud, and abuse alone. We all know that. You're hearing similar positions from all of us, which is, these are not just conservative. These are based on free market principles, capitalism. And one thing that hasn't been mentioned that's an element to America's promise and success in the future is tax reform. This is an absolute component. And what we've seen, Governor Mike Pence was just announced as the running mate for Donald Trump. He's number one in the state, in the whole country, in terms of the number of jobs that were created, AAA bond rating, $2 billion plus in surplus that's in reserve there, and they lower taxes. They're rated number one in infrastructure across the whole country. So here we have conservative principles, wherever they're applied, here in Arizona, here in Indiana, anywhere, is the example, is the proof of everything we know that's great about our country. We all talk about freedoms and liberties. The very essence about personal liberty and freedom is our free market principles, that you can be successful. And government needs to get out of the way. And so we need to lower corporate taxes. We need to lower personal taxes and stop all this regulation and tackle the very things about the entitlements, the reform. It's not waste, fraud, and abuse alone. It's the entitlements that make up the bulk of this. And then prioritize, just like we do on a local level, the military, rebuilding our military, taking care of our veterans, securing our border, defending America. When we go to war, we win wars. And having that kind of leadership that we've seen throughout our history. That's what we need to do again. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question I'm going to sort of combine in two parts, and it reflects sort of on what you've just answered. And the question is, what kind of economy do you hope to see fostered by the next Congress? And as a part of that question, would you please ask whether you support a minimum wage and why? Our minimum wage increase and why? And the first person is Sean.
Right now in Flagstaff, the minimum wage is a major topic of discussion, and I've come out very strong against it. I believe it's a misguided concept. It eliminates opportunities. On the reservation, we see it very starkly. The opportunities, the entry-level jobs, are something that is missing. And that's a major opportunity that our young people miss out on in life. By raising the minimum wage, you eliminate a lot of those entry-level jobs. We've already seen the development that business will take. They will simply go around minimum wage. They will eliminate those jobs in efficiency. They will create robots or whatever they need to do to get around those type of things. So it's very clearly a misguided policy. It does not do what it's intended to do. As far as the economy, free market is simply the very best economy there is in the world. And the Congress needs to do everything they can to get out of the way. As a businessman, I certainly understand the burden that is being placed on businesses and individuals by the federal government, and we need to do everything we can at the federal level to reduce that, to reduce regulation, to reduce the hindrances for businesses and individuals, to allow our economy to grow like it did back in the golden age of development that we've seen 50 or 100 years ago. So that's the kind of development that I'd like to see. Specifically in regulations, again, we talk about the EPA. We really have got to do something about the EPA. It is a disaster. It's putting a lot of people out of work. It's putting undue stress on our businesses. Obamacare, again, we need to do everything we can as conservatives to stand up and repeal that and reduce burdens across the line. Thank you.
The kind of economy we need is one based on open and free markets where businesses can succeed and thrive and grow, employ more people, give them increases in their wages. Government's got to get out of the way. I ran a family business for 24 years. Regulations can kill businesses. We sold diesel fuel at our company, and most of the fuel went to people that drove cars or trucks on the road, but a few people bought diesel fuel for their tractors or off-road equipment. And you don't have to pay almost 50 cents a gallon of road taxes. So the federal government wants to make sure that people aren't buying the off-road diesel and putting it on road, so we have to put a dye in the fuel and have special pumps that sell the off-road diesel. IRS agents showed up many years ago at Bennett Oil Company and wanted to inspect our pumps, because on the pumps, the IRS wanted a special little sticker that informed the public that this was off-road diesel, shouldn't be used in cars or trucks. Right above it, we had a big sticker, 10 times as large as their sticker, that said the same thing: this is off-road diesel. I sent my maintenance person around. They looked at all of the pumps to make sure we had this special little IRS sticker. On the last pump, on the back side, the IRS sticker had fallen off. My maintenance person had a new sticker to put on, thought all would be good. The IRS agent said, no, it wasn't there when I saw it. There's a fine. The fine was $50,000 for not having a little 2-inch by 3-inch sticker telling the public what we were telling them with a much larger sticker right above it. I begged and pleaded with the IRS agent. Finally, she admitted that if you've never had a violation, there's a provision that you can get a warning the first time. Well, I thanked her for the warning, and then she said, but now that you've had your free warning, if I come back tomorrow or next week or next month and find one of those stickers missing, I'm going to hammer you. Those were exact words. Our maintenance person, instead of making our business better, he became a full-time sticker checker, going around and making sure that the IRS stickers were on every pump. That's the kind of craziness that government bureaucracy and regulation is killing American businesses.
That's a great example, and Ken Bennett and his family, they're loved throughout our whole state, and that's what we've got to stop our federal government from doing, I could tell you that, about our economy. Everything I referenced before about our free market principles, I want to add to that. What's being talked about a lot with Donald Trump is about our companies, our American companies that have been leaving for decades. There's a reason why, and it's this overregulation in the tax policies. There's trillions, not billions, trillions in foreign monies by U.S. companies That's offshores right now. Most of us have heard about that because we're very active voters. And we need to recover that money and investment here in the United States. So folks, this is like being a cop. These are clues, right? There's clues why and how we got here in America, where our economy nearly $20 trillion in debt. It's not just because we're spending more than we have, it's we've defied the very essence of free market principles. We are trying to choke out the creator of wealth in our nation. And then we're trying to give everybody what they believe they're entitled to, never having earned. That's what's wrong. And that's why we need a conservative to bring and echo those messages every chance he or she gets. Thank you.
Well, I absolutely forget the first part of the question because it's been a while.
The economy.
I get the minimum wage piece, but we were getting off
that
one.
What kind of economy do you hope to foster fostered by the next Congress?
Absolutely. The kind that we just did here in Arizona, where we came from that deficit we were in to where we are now. And I just can't say it enough. Experience is everything. And knowing a blueprint like I've instilled in the last 8 years, going back to Washington, and looking at deregulating like we've done here. You know, it's interesting we talk about the regulation side. You have this ADA, the Arizona, I say Arizona because it's always starting in Arizona with my acronyms, but the American Disabilities Act, and which is a good thing. The problem is when you're talking about businesses that have put a sign up and it says, it has their disability sign right here, but it's moved off just half an inch. You have lawyers out here going around looking for that to find these business owners, and it's a ruse right now. So now you got lawyers involved, you got the federal government dictating down, saying it needs to be exactly like we say it is, or it's out of compliance. And so it fosters this ability for these lawyers to go and do a ruse and take money from these business owners. We need to fix that so that they could say, okay, we see that, but you can fix that before we come in and fine you. That's what we need to do, those type of things. We need that fostered here in this great state, in this great country that we have. And I'll tell you what, we're talking about the minimum wage piece, that's the second, that'll hurt our economy. All it's gonna do is inflate. And the $1 menu at McDonald's becomes a $5 menu. And so all you're going to do is inflate the dollars of what you have to get to live on. That's all it's going to do. When $15 is your minimum, the $15 guys have to make $20 to make a living now. So we need to get back to free market.
Okay.
Thank you.
Ken, you're next on this one. A news report from Climate Progress says the GOP platform proposes to get rid of national parks and national forests. What is your position on this issue?
Well, I would certainly not support getting rid of national parks or national forests. I would like to see federal lands in Arizona return to more state control and local control. When the federal government took in trust almost two-thirds of the land in Arizona when we became a state, the idea was that once we were more secure and able to manage our affairs as a state, that those would be transferred to more local and state control. And that needs to happen. We're, I think, 103 years old now as a state, and a lot of the lands that are still held by the federal government need to be transferred to local and state control. I don't think anyone is more interested in healthy forests in Arizona, nice parks, than Arizonans. And so I believe that we need to have this control at the local level. I'll leave it to Sean to talk about the effect that holding all of their land and things in trust has on the Native American tribes. Because anything that is managed from Washington usually is managed much more poorly than things that are managed by people at the local level who interact with it, who rely on it, who use it on a daily or weekly basis. So I would not support any platform, whether it's the GOP's or anyone else's, that eliminates those things. We need to transfer the control of those things to more local levels, and I think they can be managed better here than from Washington, D.C.
Thank you. Paul.
Certainly, we want to transfer control. When you have almost 14, some say a little bit higher percentage of the land, the geography in our state that's actually personally owned and controlled, and you look at other states and how small that is in comparison. So the reason why this matters and why that's been a big issue, and most of us are supportive of local control, is when any regulation, when it comes to the EPA, when it comes to Forest Service, any of the regulatory bodies in Washington, when they make their rules and policies, it has an outsized impact on the state of Arizona. So absolutely, I'm in favor of transferring those lands control, not shutting down parks and forests. And here, we are good stewards of our environment. But look at the example of what has happened. The policies, as I mentioned earlier, in the name of protecting the environment, they are destroying it. In the past 12, 15 years, we've lost 20% of Arizona's forests for a generation, right? In the name of protecting the forests, stopping us from safely, environmentally safely, thinning our forests, cleaning the underbrush, the fuel, and we're harming our watershed at the same time. That's the result. That's what's really happening here. So, yes, local control, we've seen the impact as well when this happens. It's not just a loss of our forests, it hurts our economy. I've sent 25 deputies north to the Wallow fires, again to the recent fires, Cedar. We've had wildfires in my county where my deputies are evacuating families in Kearney and Superior because their police departments have one cop on. And I can send 20 and 30 up in 1 hour. This is what's happening. We're dealing with the impact and effect. So absolutely, as much control as we can transfer back to the state, I'm for.
Certainly, again, we're talking about experience and at the state level, I have experience within this process once again. And the knowledge that we can take back to the federal government and express to them about our public lands and why we need them back. You know, certainly I created the Ag, Water, and Lands Committee for this purpose so they could fight with Ken Ivory at the American Lands Council. He's the guy that created this American Lands Council. He's from Utah, legislator up there, fighting against the federal government so that we can get our lands back. When you're talking west of the Rockies, multiple percentages of different states are in federal control. So you talk east of the Rockies, it's less than 2% in federal hands. Our state alone is 42% in federal control when you're talking about these lands. And certainly need somebody with that in mind who understands that knowledge, knowing that less than 13% of our state is in private property hands. You know what that does to us? That limits our ability to get taxes for our education system, our public safety, for our roads, our infrastructure. If we had more of those lands in private hands, we certainly could do more with our great state. And it certainly stops us from obtaining more when we're talking about congressional delegation. You're talking 53 in California, we have 9 here. We should have plenty more here, but less than 13% is private property owned. We don't have the population to sustain that. So when you're talking about these issues in the PILT payment in lieu of taxes, it's dwindling. That's what the federal government was supposed to give us in lieu of that 42%. They're not doing it. We need somebody to go back and fight for that, make sure that we get that in lieu until we get those lands back. I promise you, when we get back there, right when I land, we're going to hit this issue right off the bat and get this under control so the regulations of our forests are out. We've got a $1 billion industry out there that's lying dormant. We need that for our economy. Thank you.
Sean.
Don't remember exactly who you said it is that said this, but boy, that sure sounds like a Democrat quote if there ever was, because I don't believe the Republicans have ever said that we need to get rid of national forests. But the things that have been discussed here are very important things for rural Arizona. We have to resist the federal government continuing to reach from Washington, from the East Coast, and come out and put their thumb on us and take our land away from us. The PILT payments that Mr. Gowan spoke about, those are a disaster. Anytime we have to go to Washington and beg for what they owe us is not a good situation. We need to have that control. And of course, the mismanagement of federal lands by the federal government is a complete disaster. Those lands need to be maintained. They need to be harvested. Forests cannot just be allowed to burn every year. We need to go in there and harvest those. We need to maintain them. We need to take advantage of the natural resources. We need to open up these lands for development and to harvest whatever it is, whether it's above or below. As they discussed, the reservations, boy, the other day, Ken and I were over at PBS, and we did an interview, and they said, well, what is your number one priority for Native Americans? And I said, land issues. Because the Native Americans, all their land is owned by the federal government. And boy, that is an extreme disaster when they're not even allowed to own their homes. They're not allowed to hold equity. So, again, I don't know where this quote comes from, but I don't think that I've ever met a Republican that says we need to get rid of those. That sounds like just one of those things like, you know, the Democrat scare tactics that we're going to kill the young and throw the old people out into the street or something like that. That's not something that we're talking about, but we do have to resist the federal government. We need to maintain state control, and we need to do that for the good of Arizona. Thank you.
Thank you. We've reached the time where we have to go to the closing statements. I still have several questions here that you wanted answered, and I'm sorry we can't get to them, but as I said before, the candidates are willing to stay after this morning so that you can personally ask some of your questions, because there are still more great questions, but we have to come to a close. So at this time, we're going to move to the closing statements, and each candidate will have 2 minutes to respond, and we start with Sean.
Well, thank you again. Thanks for putting this on. It takes a lot of effort. It sure would have been nice to have a few more people join us, but it's really good to be here. Even though Cottonwood isn't necessarily part of our district, there are some people out here that do live in CD1, and we appreciate you guys putting it on. Again, I am a local man. I'm somebody that lives in the district. I've voted in the district for a long time. I'm probably going to have to go over to Holbrook, actually, and pull my voter file, because I get asked that question all the time. Are you one of these carpetbaggers, or do you actually live in the district? Yeah, I live here. I've voted here for a lot of years. I know the diversity of this district as good as any candidate can. Like I say, I've been around a lot of different demographics. I've been with Caucasian people. I've been with minority people. I've been in business. I've been in metropolitan areas. I've been in rural areas. The town I live in now is definitely the epitome of what you call a wide spot. There's two lanes, and it just gets a little wider where I'm at. There's a shopping center. That's where I live. But, of course, I feel very comfortable when I go down to Oro Valley, into Tucson, into those metropolitan areas. I know economic development. And the biggest thing is that I am a genuine, lifelong conservative that will represent the values that our party holds dear. And the biggest thing is that I always come back to is that I will win in November. You look at Ann Kirkpatrick. She didn't even come to her celebration dinner on election night. She said, I've got to wait for the Navajo vote to come in. She came to my little wide spot of Dilcon and sat in that parking lot under the hot sun for nearly 8 hours and harvested votes. That's where they're getting it done. We can no longer, as a party, ride off that fourth of the state, that third of the state. We as a party have to go after it. And you have to have a messenger that has the ability and respect and stature in the community to be able to do that. I will stand with whoever gets this nomination. But my endorsement only carries so much. That doesn't mean a lot. But if I'm the candidate, they will vote for me, I assure you. Again, we want to turn this district red. So just remember one simple thing. Vote red like a good Republican should. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Thank you for having us here and doing this forum. It's wonderful to get it out and get up on the internet and such. And, you know, the big theme that I've been expressing out here is the experience. And being Speaker of the House of the whole great state of Arizona, I've served you guys for 8 years. I've served you well. I've served the rural regions well. It is my passion. It's actually, I have to tell you, it's the best job I've ever had is serving the people. And I don't care that I'd have congressmen next to my name. What I care about is getting back there and making sure that we do what's proper for this great state and we do what's right for America. And, you know, I have issues here. We talked about the budget, went through all of that with you, went through the veterans, how the veteran support. We went through all the other issues when we're talking about our border security. And I didn't get to end on that piece, so I'm going to give you what we had there in the budget at the end. We got together a DPS border strike force to help our local police officers down that way, make sure they stop the illegal incursion that's happening down on our border. There are things and experiences that I have that I can take to the federal government. And like I've stated before, when I get off that plane, I'm not looking for the restroom. I'm looking to shake hands, take names. I have the experience to do this job. I love the constituency. I have the experience of going out and talking to all our constituents. I will never stop doing that. I would ask each and every one of you, make sure you Google every one of us. I am proud of my record. You can see who I am off of that. I am proud to be an Arizonan. I'm proud to be in the freest state in the nation and the greatest country in the world. And I plan to take these values back there. I am a patriot. And I will continue to fight for us back in Washington, D.C., and make sure, again, as I said before, they respect us out here in Arizona. They respect the West. So God bless you guys. Thank you for having me here. And vote Gowan, GowanForArizona.com.
Putting America first. I say oftentimes for once. We've seen a great erosion of that, talking about refugees, asylum seekers. There's a lot of countries who are hurting out there. But it doesn't mean we put their needs and their priorities ahead of our own as citizens and our families and our country. That's got to stop. And I've communicated this, not just in the campaign. I've talked about this for 8 years as a sheriff, securing our border, enforcing the law, going after the cartels with results. We have the largest drug bust in the history of Arizona was led by our deputies in Pinell County, $3 billion. We're arresting 21 cartel scouts on mountaintops in the past 2 years. We're not even on the border. These are cartel lookouts. And it just underscores how we have put others before our own people. That's going to end. I believe that we're going to have a Republican president, Donald Trump, and Governor Pence. And I want to be, instead of a Democrat liberal vote that represents District 1, that's lockstep, we're going to have a conservative Republican that votes for a balanced budget to stop deficit spending, to take care of our military veterans, that solemn promise I talked to you about earlier. There's 40,000 military veterans plus in District 1, and then their families. Let's put them first. Let's take care of them. Talking about the EPA and forest health and the wildfires and the overreach of the federal government. Somebody who stood up actually physically face-to-face to the president and not turning, but holding him to account. That's what's beautiful about our republic. Having that, even as a freshman, bringing that message to Washington for Arizona. Thank you.
As all have said, thank you very much for coming this morning. I look around and I think if you take out the ones that are here for specific candidates and their staff and things like that, there's probably just a handful of you that are maybe thinking, how do I distinguish between these four and other two that aren't here today? We are not going to change Washington and the direction of our country unless we elect people who have a proven record of getting things done. And I will suggest the distinguishing factor, I guess, about me is represented by two numbers, 16,000 and 40 billion. 16,000 is the number of paychecks I estimate that I signed as the CEO of our family business for 23 or 24 years. I know how to create jobs. I know how to deal with the overregulations that many of us have talked about. I know what it's like to see the satisfaction on an employer's and an employee's face when they get a paycheck and they can use that to send a child to college and provide a better opportunity for them than maybe they had. 40 billion is the number of, that's the value of the state of Arizona budgets that I balanced when I was Senate president. And I did it, as I said, with a Democrat governor. And we not only got 15 out of 17 Republicans to support those budgets, 11 out of 13 Democrats. We figured out how to work across the aisle. We did the largest tax cut in the history of the state of Arizona. We put over $1 billion into the state's rainy day fund. We eliminated hundreds of millions of dollars of accounting tricks and gimmicks that both parties had used for decades. But we also put more money into K-12 education and the universities. To veteran services, we started the funding that created the Veterans Home in Tucson. Child Protective Services got significant increases to help our children. We need people who are in public service for the service, not the publicity. And we need people who have a proven record of getting things done and working across the aisle to move America forward. And that's what Ken Bennett will do for you. Thank you for being here today.
Thank you. I have a couple of public service announcements, if you will, before we end. First of all, there is quite a bit of information around the outside of the room. All of the candidates have brought information, so please feel free to pick that up. We also have information from Vote Smart, which is an organization dedicated to putting nonpartisan election information at your fingertips. It focuses on state and national candidates and issues, and it offers an easy-to-use website with detailed and reliable facts. Also know that it is not endorsed by the League, but the information is here available for you. We also have voter registration going on outside, so if you have not registered to vote, please do so. If you are new to the state or recently moved here, be sure to register to vote. The deadline is August 1st for the primary election. Early voting for the primary election begins on August 3rd. Those who are registered to vote, non-preference, independent, can vote in the primary election. Those voting early need to request a ballot from the county election department, from the political party they want to vote in, and when going to vote at the polls, just request the ballot from the political party you want to vote in. I would like to personally thank Ken, Paul, Dave, and Sean on behalf of the League of Women Voters and the Cottonwood Chamber for being here and sharing your time with us and providing information about who you are and what you stand for so that we can all make more informed decisions. And I'd like to thank all of you for being here to participate as well. Have a wonderful day.
Well done. Thank you.